Hi, Jimmy. Thanks so much for joining us today for Hoya Gateway's virtual Power Lunch interview. We're excited to ask questions from Georgetown students to learn more about your career. A little bit about Jimmy before we get started. Jimmy Ramirez is a creative media professional at Google, where he partners with Hollywood studios to execute inclusive marketing campaigns. At Google, he has led cross-functional campaigns that speak to underrepresented audiences, notably working on the deployment of the Marsha P Johnson doodle. Prior to Google, he worked in the communications department of the Obama White House. Jimmy graduated from the Georgetown College with a degree in government and a minor in justice and peace and film studies in 2015. And now we'll dive right into questions. Jimmy, welcome.
Awesome.
And our first question here is, what advice do you have for someone exploring the tech industry as a career option, especially in marketing skills from non-tech classes and club involvement?
I think, so when I go to campus and I meet with students or doing recruiting events or kind of just get folks ready for the world of tech, the best piece of advice I got is to like numerize everything and basically make all of your experiences into a numeric value to demonstrate impact. So these companies are just, they're so large and there's so many moving pieces that for, you know, in my career where I'm looking, it's a lot about, well, you know, and I'm in the sales side of the business, right? And so what revenue am I bringing in and what dollars am I bringing in? And so I'm constantly thinking about numbers and numbers to bring in. And so when you're thinking about Georgetown, when you're trying to demonstrate the impact on campus, right, try and think about it from an executive perspective. Like, what large partnerships did you establish? How many students did you maybe get into Georgetown or guide into Georgetown? Really just try and paint a realistic picture with data, because at the end of the day, I work in an engineering company, right? Like, I'm in Hollywood and I'm kind of doing that, you know, having those conversations and showing up to the table in that way. But on the other side of the house, like, I'm also working and dealing with engineers, right? And so there is a significant need to kind of know your data, and kind of when you know your story, know why you're doing something, have data to back it up and to substantiate the impact you've led or your passion. And so a lot of the time I spend with students in recruiting is like, okay, cool, you're involved with GSP or you're involved with JUGS, right? Like, these really awesome organizations. How do we tell a really cool data-oriented story so that we can demonstrate you as leader, passionate, whatever these adjectives you want to be seen as?
That's a really thoughtful answer and something that I think relates across many different industries nowadays.
It's numbers are everything. So it's just,
The next question we have here for you, Jimmy, is what was your mindset going into your junior year of university?
Junior year. So junior year, I had applied to this program called MLT. It's Management Leadership for Tomorrow. So it's a program for Black and Brown young professionals entering their junior year. It's a program started by John Rice and John Legend. So every time we see John Legend on TV, my mom's like, he got my son a job. Like, cause he started this professional organization, which is like super rad. And basically what they do is they coach you through how to go into an interview, how to tell that numeric story, right? How that data-driven story, but then how to have like the tightest and cleanest resume anywhere, right? Like, how to differentiate yourself right from the get-go of like when that recruiter pulls your resume out. So I think the mode, I was a total shark going into junior year. Like, I was involved in the center, you know, Center for Social Justice, don't get me wrong. Like, I was doing all my things and like doing all my passion activities, but I was really, really bent on getting a job, because that's what, you know, like, I needed that economic security. And so I was just relentlessly working on my resume, relentlessly like reaching out to people in the network, right? I was talking to people at EY, you name it. I was talking to recruiters just to look at my resume. So it was just a matter of like, I was getting all my tools together to go into those conversations.
I think that's a great tip to really just prepare yourself as much as you can during that time.
Yeah. Cause you're like, when you're at Georgetown, like, I was working like three jobs. Like, it was wild. Right. And then you have like all the little functions and you have like, you know, the new homies that you're making and whatever events you're doing. And so like having all that stuff pristine, that way you can enjoy yourself during the school year and kind of have that ready to go. Because once it's ready, like once your resume is good, then you can go to all the little parties. You can't really do that now, right, because of COVID, but like you can, you know, really indulge yourself once that's taken care of, was kind of my attitude.
Thanks for sharing that with us, Jimmy. The next question here is, what is a skill you wish you learned in college?
Skill I wish I learned in college. I wish I paid attention more in statistics, straight up. Like, it was just like, I was that big ICC classroom, and I was just like, I could, for some reason, could not focus. And the amount of like statistics I have to do in my day job to tell those data-driven stories, I just wish I kind of spent more time there, spent more time in the data side of the house. But I will say, like, the film program that like I went through, the peace program that I went through at Georgetown, I will say like conflict resolution studies got me better for corporate America than any other, which is just the truth, right? Like, because you're constantly dealing with different priorities.
On the opposite side of that, what are skills that you are super grateful to have learned in addition to those?
The notion of like Hoyas for others. I love that being ingrained in just in my psyche, in the way I showed up at work, in the way like at Georgetown, when you do group activities or you do events, right? Like, that is ingrained in everything that you do. And I think what I found in my career, like that being kind of a value and a principle and something I've learned to kind of always bring up and not be afraid to bring up in conversations, I've just found it so beautiful to like connect with Hoyas who are generations out from me, or even, you know, current students who still have that same value and that same principle of like not being afraid to kind of bring those values up. That was my favorite thing about Georgetown, is like just be unapologetic about my values and like bring them into all the work that I'm doing.
Definitely things that students take into account now too, I think.
Yeah, and everyone wants to work with a Georgetown student, because we're just like, there's like an international component, and there's like a loving component, and there's a like a service component, and we just, it's a holistic picture. And so like, yeah, I would be remiss if I didn't mention that. Georgetown gave me that.
The next question we have here is, what is your Google work culture experience? How has Google helped you thrive as an employee?
So Google's been really, really like a place where I can really have earnest conversations with people, right? And I think that's what we're feeling right now during COVID, working from home, is I don't have those tea chats or that, you know, like walking into the, because we have micro kitchens, right, pre-COVID. And so there was this like these beautiful interactions with like other coworkers where you can just kind of talk about the world and things, right? And the people are very, very, very kind. And I think on that component, being a brown professional, right, being Latino, there's a lot of space for me as a professional to ladder up to leaders who look like me or who care about the same issues as me. So I'm currently lead of the queer trans POC collective. So folks who identify at Google who identify as queer people of color. And so that's where, right, because we have this collective power at Google, that's where we got to partner and, you know, actually execute the Marsha P Johnson doodle, right? Because we had a collective bargaining power within the company, and how do we make sure queer kids see themselves represented on the Google doodle? I was able to kind of show up as like, even as a junior and rising kind of mid-management level of my career, like I'm able to kind of show up in those conversations. I'm going to be invited to those conversations. And then on that same front, you know, with being Latino and kind of looking up the chain and not seeing anybody who looks like me or has my background, I'm able to kind of fluidly express that and then actively work towards building community with other like-minded professionals. So right now, actually partnering with some internal Googlers to actually host a conversation of folks who've actually exited incarceration. So folks who are coming out of the prison system, and, you know, it's a very big conversation right now in Hollywood, right? Like you have Ava DuVernay, who's doing phenomenal things on it. Oprah, in her network, she's doing really cool and interesting things. You have the Kardashians now having conversations on it. And so what does it look like for media professionals in Hollywood who are Black and brown? I'm able to kind of architect that conversation and get folks upskilled. So there is just a lot of authority given to Googlers within my company, right? Like the people see you as the authority on topics, and so they let you run with it.
Thank you for sharing that. And I think Kim Kardashian was a guest appearance at one of the classes about prison reform. So definitely relevant.
Yeah, one of the artists that we're partnering with actually introduced her and Kanye at like a prison reform. And it's very interesting, right? Because like, are they bringing substance to the conversation? That's a whole other conversation. But it's a very, conversations are being had. So like, how do we make sure we bring the folks impacted to the forefront? Google's allowing me to do that. And it's, it's just like a neat intersection of tech, Hollywood, justice. Yeah. It's experiment with a lot of things, right? You prototype a lot of things within tech.
It sounds like the question, the second part of that question was if Google helps you thrive as an employee, and it sounds like they are helping you thrive in a multitude of ways.
I will say when I came into Google, it was really tough, right? Because I mean, for example, the company didn't, you know, things around relocation and those components, but the company allows you to voice those. So for example, when I was at Google in Michigan, so I started out my career in Michigan, went to the San Francisco office, and then went to LA, which is a beauty of Google, right? Like, you can go all around the world with the company, which is really, really special. When I came to Michigan, I was the only Latino employee there, right? And then we had, you know, a few join the company, and then basically I would flag to these executives that the retention of Latino employees was abysmal, right? Like, it was just not a good look for the company, didn't make me feel comfortable at the company. And so this executive gave me a pool of money to basically put on a retreat for Latino Googlers. And so then that retreat evolved into now every Latino Googler that starts within the business organization of Google now gets to go on this retreat. There is that room to have those like adult conversations with executives. And then also like, what does the support look like? And what does the infrastructure look like, right? To my point around like prisons and having folks exiting, talking about that. If we have brown Googlers who feel not represented, well then what does the scaffolding look like with supporting them? And so the executive support I've received and kind of the programs I've been able to build with colleagues have just been super great, right? Like, so I kind of just share that to say that like, don't enter these companies expecting all that scaffolding there. There is a way for you to build that out for yourself. And if there is infrastructure there, like employee resource groups, you could take it to the next level. So, which Hoyas always do, you know, we're good at it.
That advocacy is super ingrained.
Yes, yes. Hoyas for others, yes.
The next question here is, what are your top three pieces of advice that you wish you had when you were applying for your job at Google?
Okay, so three things, super effective, like going into an interview with Google and just kind of making sure to keep in mind. I'd say first and foremost, take a look at a company's brand, right? So like what I did with Google is I looked at what the story Google was telling its consumers, right? Like what was the story at the time, and right, markets change, things fluctuate. So the stories can fluctuate as well. And so I spent a lot of time understanding what that story was Google was telling to consumers, right? And then I imagined, okay, my own story, I'm staying true to my story. What parts of that are the most authentic, and where can I kind of bring those together so that folks who are in this company culture and in the values of that company, they just see me as a shoe-in because my values are the same, right? Like I would kind of say at the time when I was applying for Google, there was a really, really big focus on, and there still is, on like upping digital literacy for underrepresented communities, right? And I had been doing that work with the Obama administration. I had been kind of having those types of conversations. And so I had made myself known as like I can really contribute to this value in the company, and I will show up in this way every day because it's a part of who I am. So that'd be like kind of the first piece. The second piece, really, really just like when you're doing an interview, have like a good like 20 second bit on what you're trying to tell the story of, and then really get ready for that 20 second piece to turn into a 2 minutes. So like, don't get really hung up on like giving a speech and giving like a whole monologue, right? It's a conversation, because a piece of your resume or piece of what you're saying might really resonate really strongly for that 10 second piece, and they might just want that 5 second, and then they might want to turn that 5 second into 3 minutes. So just be ready to go that way with it. It's a fluid conversation. The final thing I'll say is like when you're doing an internship or you're kind of taking a full-time role at any company, the number one thing I've like learned in Google is just track your kind of that data numeric story I've been saying, track all of your impact at the company, because like you are your own advocate at the end of the day. Like no one is, you are only going to look out for yourself, right? Like you are going to be your best advocate. And so really kind of keeping a diary of like, this is the partnerships I led, the impact I led is going to be key. That's key for promotion. That's key for kind of understanding your own career journey when you look back, right? Like what did I really care about? What did I put at the forefront? So just kind of keep that diary throughout all your jobs. I would highly recommend.
Thanks for sharing that, Jimmy. The next question here is, what can Georgetown students do to make the most of their time before they go into their careers?
Try everything. Try and break everything. And just speaking from my own experience, like I was I was a college student because like I love politics, right? Like I ended up going and working in that space for a little bit, but like I took a Yumi Park class, which was like feminization of globalization, and like it was a conversation on like basically on women's rights and kind of how we can show up for women labor forces across you know all countries. And it was a very out of the box thing for, and I learned a lot, right? And it just kind of like it, I fell into that justice and peace studies minor, I fell into the film studies minor, so just like poke and prod and like do every type of club, say yes to everything, and then like the things that are cool and that are really true to you will arise. Just like go for it all is like, because right, like they're billing you for it, so like if you're spending your, you know, like there's a tuition cost for it, like get your money's worth, you know.
I think that's great advice. And our last question here is, what advice do you have for Hoyas who are preparing to go into their first job? So we're thinking already about our class of 2021.
Oof. Sending all love to class of 2021, because it's just a different environment, right? COVID and all those pieces. I think best piece of advice, because I'm assuming that this cohort will be working from home, ideally, right? Best piece of advice is just make your bed. Because your bed is going to become your bedroom and your like living room and all those pieces are going to become your workspace. And so like really just like get up in the morning and make your bed and create boundaries between work, play, work and life, work and like who you are. Because, you know, I have a lot of professionals that I deeply admire, and I'm seeing just like with COVID, I mean, we're all going through it. There's like so many emotions right now, but like really set boundaries for yourself, because this is very irregular. This is not the norm. And so having your laptop right next to your bed and then all in the same space is just gonna, it's a lot. And so I can't imagine entering as a young professional right now into this space, but like the thing that has kept me sane is like, if I wake up and make my bed and I don't hop right into my meetings, like everything just feels good after that.
Excellent advice about that division of work, home, and fun that we all have to take a part of to kind of keep sane nowadays.
Yeah, absolutely.
Well, Jimmy, thank you so much for your time today. Do you have any parting words for our students before we go?
If I am always down to refer folks to Google, like I'm always down to read a resume, especially Black and Brown young professionals, first generation professionals. Like I will hop on the phone for 10 minutes and I'll do what I can, just because that is what folks have done for me. And just don't be afraid to ask Hoyas for help. Like never ask the network. Never forget, like never feel shame in asking the network for help.
Thanks so much, Jimmy.
Of course, thank you for the time. I really appreciate it.